may God be the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, you our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Quite simply, today I'm just going to be sharing with you a few thoughts and then some information that any number of us might not have been familiar with as it relates to Black history. Certainly the month of Black history on some levels presents a sense of lamenting. Lamenting is a certain way of expressing our sorrow and sadness. Lamentations can give us an opportunity to be honest and to be bold about our raw emotions. When we lament, we can express our deepest pain through that lament, because it's an honest prayer of pain, grief, and sorrow. And in sharing our laments, we join that rich Christian history, at least, of lamentations. We join with the psalmist who wept. We join with Jeremiah, with Hannah, with Mary, and Martha, and with Jesus. There's that line in Scripture that says, "Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness." So God created humankind. God saw everything, and indeed, it was very good. Matthias, play the opening video for the decade, please, if you can. No, it's not that one, Matthias. That's the last one. Maybe if you want to see the videos, you should come down, because there'll be two through this, so. Unless you have eyes on the back of your head. Can't find it? Oh, wow. Okay, well, there's another link, but we'll forget that video, and I shall continue on. It's a video from the United Nations speaking to the decade. That we find ourselves in. I'm not sure what your experience of racism has been like during your time of being on planet Earth, but I can tell you that I've certainly experienced lots of it in Mississauga, certainly lots of it since I've even come back to Kingston. A historical lesson. Although anthropologists and Egyptologists and Africanists are not in agreement on the exact racial classification of the people of Africa, There is general agreement that Africa is indeed the cradle of civilization and one of the earliest and most spectacular civilizations of antiquity. Africans have been known for their trade with other nations, military acumen, early intellectual and artistic expressions which reside in museums all around the world. The term African is not an original name for people who originate on the continent. The name Africa came into Western use through the Romans, who used the name Africa Terra, land of the Afri, plural or Afer, singular, for the northern part of the continent, as the province of Africa with its capital Carthage corresponding to modern-day Tunisia. The Old Testament cities, ancient Kush, Ethiopia, 13,000 to 7,500 BC, over 40 times, and Egypt over 100 times. Kush, modern-day Ethiopia, and Egypt are countries located in the northeastern region of Africa for those who have forgotten their geography. Kush is the home of the Garden of Eden, also known as the cradle of civilization. Two of the four rivers mentioned in Genesis 2, 8 to 13 flowed through ancient Kush, the Pishon and Gihon. Kush, the Hebrew term, was later renamed by the Greeks and transposed into Ethiops, Ethiopia, which literally meant burnt-faced people. The people of faith. You and I know every part of humanity is a reflection, an embodiment of the wisdom and power of the Holy One. Yet all of our collective humanity has been diminished and ruptured through the enslavement of African peoples and the colonization and exploitation of those same peoples' land. One of the ways the Church is engaging with the decade is by doing targeted work towards combating racism, racial discrimination, xenophobia, and related intolerances faced by people of African descent. We know that prayer has the power to transform and amplify our actions. And so we are invited as people to pray during this midway point we find ourselves in the decade for the human rights and the fundamental freedoms of people of African descent. I share with you this note from Paul Douglas Walthall, who is one of the ministry personnel in Fort Saskatchewan Pastoral Church. He writes, "In 2017, I received then the latest issue of the Journal of the Historical Society of Alberta Northwest Conference of the United Church of Canada. In that issue, I was particularly interested in the article. It was entitled The KKK and the Church, written by Reverend Lloyd Lovett. It was interesting reading, and yet it was also difficult at points to absorb. I read that the Ku Klux Klan came to Alberta in the 1920s through the work of a Methodist and then a United Church minister. Equally difficult was to read that clergymen of the United Church of Canada were Klansmen, and to note that at the time the United Church had the unsavory reputation, according to the writer of the book, The Ku Klux Klan in Central Alberta, of being a church that refused to condemn the Klan's activities. The article also noted that in 1927, a resolution came to the Saskatchewan Conference not to support the Ku Klux Klan in any way. The conference ultimately accepted the recommendation. The conference refrained from making any deliverance on the question. This was particularly difficult to hear, and I wondered what was happening to the church at that time. Indeed, the silence of the church then seemed to have been a betrayal of many things I hold most dear. Yet I will not condemn the conference of the church for its silence then, but I will wonder when there is silence by the church on the issues of racism in our contemporary society. Paul happens to be a black man. It is February, and once again, we are observing Black History Month in Canada. Black history in Canada is the history of Canada. In this month, we will be acknowledging and celebrating the accomplishments of many black people, and rightfully so. Yet if all we do is to only acknowledge the points of celebration, then I believe we would not be looking at the truth. For history is made up of good and bad experiences, and both must be recognized. It is when we recognize the unpleasant things in life of the past that we can appreciate just how far we have come as a society. It makes even more significant the things that are to be celebrated, but it also challenges us to learn from the past. You see, if we do not learn from our history, then we will repeat the same mistakes in the future. It's interesting to note that back in the 20s, the federal government of Canada was afraid as the people from the states were flying out because of the Jim Crow time. The federal government of Canada was afraid that there was going to be a black takeover. A piece of history I was not aware of. While you and I have come a long way in society and in the church, there is still much more that needs to be done and we need to be a part of. Okay, Matthias, does the second video work? Okay. And if it doesn't, let me know. And we'll press on. This is Maya Angelou, one of my favorite all-time persons in time. And if for some reason you don't get to listen to this piece that she wrote when she was speaking to the United Nations, go home and Google it. Is there a mute on the sound on the video, Matthias? Because usually there is with these YouTubes. No? No? Okay. Take it off. No, you got it back on. There you go. Press play now. No? Okay, you can forget it. Well, sorry about that, folks. We'll have to get on top of that this week. So, because we have a little extra time, I'd like you, if you're sitting alone, I want you to connect with somebody else that's nearby and to take about 4 minutes to discuss any one of the three questions there that you see just below the video in your order of worship. Where have you experienced racism in your time? What do you know about the history and the legacy of slavery? And what myths about racism in Canada and slavery are you aware of that others might not be? So simply turn and share with each other what it is you know or have experienced. Are you okay? Because I can come up there, Shannon, if you want me to. I can come up. Okay? That's okay. Do you want me to come up there, or do you want to come down here? Okay, all right. You sure? And then I'll stand here. Can I stand behind you, Susan? Okay. Yeah? Mm-hmm. You haven't experienced it, but have you experienced it in other ways? No? Well, have you been somewhere where somebody's made comments and... Absolutely. Unfortunately, where I live up in Mississauga, the Peel Police Force, and a lot of people don't know that they are the dirtiest police force in all of Canada. And I've actually even had friends of mine who are cops in other police organizations. They've told me, and I've seen it firsthand. But you know where I experienced, and I probably didn't even understand it as racism at that time. My first experience of racism goes back to probably 1962. When I was, I think I was 11 or 10 at the time. No, I was 11, I think, or 10 at the time. And here in Kingston, because Kingston's home, and up on Hillcrest Avenue. And so I'm not even sure what grade I would have been in. But anyways, down the street, a black family moved in to a house behind the church. Behind the church I was raised in. And Roxbury West. Roxroy West, that was his name, and he was a part of the class that I was in at Kingsport Public School. And I made instant friends with him. It was just, I knew he was black, but that wasn't there. And I had people going after me, saying, what are you doing being a friend with a black person? Now, here's the thing. So Roxbury, and he ended up after 2 or 3 years moving, and only recently did I discover this, probably within just over 2 years ago. I was standing in up on Davies 3, which is the cardiac floor, and I was in the big waiting room over on the far side of the building. And I'm looking on the wall, and there's a picture, and then there's this award that had been given. It's in a container of some kind, to the head cardiologist in Kingston, and his name was Dr. West. And his picture was there. And that's who Roxbury's father was. So he must have been, they might have been probably one of, few black people here in Kingston at the time. But still to this day, and I have family members who say to me, well, there's black people. And I say to them, this is where what I do is I say, I'm sorry, but, don't talk like that if I'm going to be around you, because I just can't tolerate that. So. happens if you could wind it down and you can carry that conversation on in whatever ways you want to afterwards. Maybe the choir, does the choir want to move back up front? Yes. Yeah, I know they do. So as we come out and regather, we're going to sing a More Voices piece. No, I'll leave it now. Thanks, though. Please. I'm going to invite you, if it's not on the screen, to turn in More Voices 88 over my head. This is an African-American spiritual. I know it, and I know how to sing it the way I sing it, but I'll let the choir provide the leadership they're going to provide. This is a really good piece. We're only singing the first three verses, and so it's going to go, I hear the music over my head, you know. I hear music in the air. Second verse, when the winds of strife are blowing, you'll see that as number two on your right-hand side at the bottom. And then number three, when the tide of hate is rising. That's how you begin as we're singing it. So Rory's going to cue us by playing a bit of it first before we join in the singing of it, right? And if you want to stand, you can stand. That means you can tap your foot if you want. You can snap your fingers. Over my head, I hear music in the air. Over my head, I hear music in the air. Over my head, I hear music in the air. There must be a God somewhere. Music in the air. Hear music in the air. Hear music in the air. May there be a God somewhere. Over my head, I hear music in the air. Over my head, music in the air. Over my head, I hear music in the air. There must be a God somewhere. Hear music in the air. I hear music in the air. I hear music in the air. There must be a God somewhere. Over my head, I hear music in the air. Over my head, I hear music in the air. Over my head, I hear music in the air. There must be a God somewhere. There is music in the air, in the tide of the day. There is music in the air. I hear music in the air. There must be a God somewhere. Over my head, I hear music in the air. Over my head, Sitting down, just by way of background, one of the stories that's told about this old spiritual is that when the Underground Railroad was happening and they were hiding out in the basements of churches and hearing it, they'd sing this song until nightfall when they could leave. At this time, we'll receive the offerings of our life and of our work.
Hope. You light a candle of hope. Hope because God is still at work in our world. We believe that love is stronger than all the ills of the world. The legacies of slavery still exist in our world, and persons of African descent are still the recipients of racism. These are some of the realities in our world. We are called to let the light of God's love shine in the world. Candle of commitment. As we light this candle, let us also commit ourselves to bear the light of the hope of our lives. In doing so, let us commit ourselves to work for a world that is more just, more loving, and more caring, and where we live in the right relations.
Let us pray. God, our lives, we come as a broken and confused people before you. We come as a people who have all somewhere along the line been victims of wicked and greedy powers. We've been fooled to think that we are superior to one another, and we have acted upon that belief in one way or another. Grant us wisdom and clarity as we find ways to enter into or maintain relationships with our black siblings and cousins this month. Give us the opportunity to get to know each other through service and dialogue. Soothe us from the awkward conversations that we will pursue in the name of togetherness and understanding. Holy One of our world, be with all peoples throughout the nations as they struggle with concepts that are both familiar and unfamiliar to us. We raise to you our migrant siblings and cousins in Libya who have been exploited and sold into slavery. We raise to you their loved ones, spouses, parents, and children who wait for them to return, but who may wait in vain. We raise those who are weary from war, starving from famine, broken from sexual exploitation and violence. May they know you as the one who will renew their strength. Holy One of the world, whisper our love to them and grant us ways to aid them in their difficult time. God of the universe, we bring ourselves on this day, for we are facing different hardships at the moment in our lives. But just as you know the makeup of each starry host, so too are you aware of who we are and what we are facing. Activate your hope within us so that we may rely on the strength and comfort you offer. And so now we pray as a child to a mother and to a father, and we join together in the prayer of Jesus, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Our closing hymn this morning is in Voices United 691. this day, having learned something, remembered something about our history. And as we go, may we take that learning and apply it in such ways that we can embrace anyone of any color, of any race in our world with love. May we go in peace. Thank you.